Happy Thanksgiving, everyone! Today we're going to play a game to help us remember all of the great things we have to be thankful for this season. I'm going to show you two different items, and then you get to choose which one you're most thankful for. You might be thankful for both, but you have to choose the one you're most thankful for by doing whatever action is shown on the screen. Got it? Good. Here are your first two choices. If you love dogs, then I want you to jump up and down as fast as you can. But if you love cats even more, then I want you to clap your hands as fast as you can. Nice job. That was fun. All right, catch your breath. Let's try two more. If you love pizza, then I want you to stretch your arms as high up as you can. But if you love tacos even more, then I want you to reach down and touch your toes. Great job. Let's see what these next two will be. If you love books, then I want you to stand on one foot. But if you'd rather watch a movie, then I want you to spin in circles. All right. I bet all of you movie lovers are feeling a little dizzy. These next two will be a little easier. If you love fruit, then I want you to march in place. But if you love vegetables even more, then I want you to freeze and stand perfectly still. Great job. All right, we've just got a few left. Let's see what these next two are. If you love playing sports, any kind of sport, then I want you to do jumping jacks as fast as you can. But if you love playing video games even more, then I want you to do your best victory dance. Nice job. Let's see what our last two will be. If you love ice cream, then I want you to wave your hands in the air. But if you love candy even more, then I want you to flap your arms like chicken wings. Great job, everyone. That was so much fun. God has really given all of us so much to be thankful for. Let's not forget to tell Him thank you this Thanksgiving.
Good morning, Kendall Christian students, staff, and families. Today is Thursday, November 12th, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to our worship service today. Let's get things started with our call to worship. Our call to worship comes from Psalm chapter 148. This verse tells us that all of creation should praise the Lord. But what does the word praise actually mean? One way of praising someone is to talk about something good the person has done. Has your mom or dad ever praised you? In Psalm 148, the word praise appears over 12 times, and all that praise is for God. The psalmist reminds us of a few of the zillion reasons why we should praise God. Listen, the psalm tells the sun, the moon, and the stars to praise God because God made them. How could the sun, the moon, and the stars praise God? Well, maybe they could praise God by just shining and being the beautiful things that God created them to be. And maybe we can praise God just by being the beautiful people that God created us to be. The psalmist tells us that the mountains and the hills, the trees, the wild animals, and even the creepy crawling things and the birds of the air to praise God for making them so amazing. At the end of the psalm, the writer tells all the people, rulers, kings, old men, girls, boys, young men and young women, old and young and in between. Everybody get up and tell about, sing about the wonderful, marvelous things that God has done, including making you. So let's get up right now and praise God for who He is and what He has done for us.
See you.
All right, boys and girls, welcome back. So we've reached the point in our chapel where I usually play a game with you. Since we just had an election, I thought it might be fun to quiz you on some presidential facts. When you think you know the answer, go ahead and shout it out. Ready? Number one, who was the tallest president? Was it George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, Abraham Lincoln? Did you say Abraham Lincoln? That's right. Abraham Lincoln was over 6'4" tall. Number two, who was the shortest president? Was it James Madison, George W. Bush, Grover Cleveland? The correct answer is James Madison. He was only 5'4". That's a whole foot shorter than Abraham Lincoln. Ready for our next one? Which president weighed the most? Bill Clinton, William Howard Taft, or Andrew Jackson? The answer to this question is William Howard Taft. He weighed over 300 pounds. Which president weighed the least? Was it James Madison, John F. Kennedy, or Ronald Reagan? The correct answer is James Madison. He weighed less than 100 pounds. All right, get ready for a tricky one. Who was the youngest man to be president? Was it Teddy Roosevelt, Dwight D. Eisenhower, or Herbert Hoover? The correct answer is Teddy Roosevelt. He was only 41 years old when he became president. Who was president for the longest? Was it George Washington, Franklin D. Roosevelt, Barack Obama? The correct answer is Franklin D. Roosevelt. Who was president for the shortest amount of time? Was it Ulysses S. Grant, William Henry Harrison, or Jimmy Carter? The correct answer is William Henry Harrison. He was only president for 21 days. That's 3 weeks. Great job, boys and girls. Let me ask you a question. Was there more than one answer for any of these questions? No. Only one person can be the oldest, or the youngest, or the shortest, or the tallest when you are comparing traits. Did you know that God has a name that tells us that He is the most? The name is El Elyon. How is God the most? Well, God is the most perfect, the most powerful, the most wise, kind, good, faithful, creative, generous, happy, patient, and the list could go on and on. God is greater than anyone or anything. He is El Elyon, the Most High. Can you think of the greatest people of all time? You may think of a president like George Washington, or an inventor like Thomas Edison, or a writer like Dr. Seuss, or a ruler like King David. But God is better than all of these people. He is better than the greatest king. In fact, God is named the King of Kings. Every country has some kind of government, and every government has some kind of leader. Maybe the leader is called a president, or a prime minister, or a king, or a queen. People usually look at those leaders as powerful or important. The Bible tells us about a great king who thought that one day he would be better than God. Our story today is found in Daniel chapter 4. And to understand this story, you have to understand a little bit about the history of the Israelite people. God has promised the Israelites that he would be their God and that a savior would come from the tribe of Judah, one of the tribes of Israel. The Israelites had been taken over by a neighboring country called Babylon, and the king of Babylon did not believe in the God of the Israelites. He had several encounters with some of God's people. Our story takes place just after the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. In that story, God had appeared with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace. Yet the king of Babylon did not recognize him and did not recognize God as the Lord Most High. Although King Nebuchadnezzar was amazed by the escape of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and the fourth man that he saw in the furnace, he still did not follow the Lord. So the Lord gave Nebuchadnezzar a dream to warn him. The dream frightened the king, and he called on his wisest men to interpret it. But no one could tell him what it meant. Finally, with the help of the Lord, Daniel came to interpret the king's dream. In his dream, the king saw a large tree that reached to the heavens. The tree provided fruit for everyone to eat, shade for the animals, and a place for birds to build their nests. But God ordered the tree to be cut down and destroyed so that only the stump of the tree was left. Then God said the stump was a man who should be bound with iron and sent to live with the cattle in the field. He should eat grass with them, and his mind would be like the mind of a beast in the field. In this way, he would learn that God rules over men. When Daniel heard the dream, he was frightened by what it meant. But the king wanted to hear the interpretation, no matter how bad it was. So Daniel explained, "O king, the tree stands for you and your power. God is going to cut you down and send you away from men, so that you will live out in the field to eat grass like an ox." But Daniel explained, "After you repent of your sins, God will restore you. Then you will know God rules over the kingdoms of men." Daniel urged the king to turn from his sins to avoid this disaster. But the king did not repent. 1 year later, as the king walked along his roof, admiring all of his work, he proudly said, "Is this not the great Babylon, which I have built by my mighty power, for the glory of my majesty?" Before the king was even finished speaking, God spoke from heaven, "The kingdom has been taken away from you. You will be sent away to live with the animals until you know that God is the one who rules the kingdoms of men." And that's exactly what happened. Nebuchadnezzar's human reason left him, and he was driven out of his palace to live among the animals. His nails grew long like a bird's claws, and he ate grass like an ox. He stayed that way until he repented of his pride. Only then did his reason return. After that, instead of praising himself, he praised God and said, "Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of Heaven, for all his works are right and his ways are just, and those who walk in pride he is able to humble." When we read the story of Israel's captivity in Babylon, it can seem as though God's plan for his people failed. But God used the kings who defeated Israel to discipline his people and rescue them from the destruction that sin would bring. God turns bad things into good things. So you see, Israel's captivity was part of God's plan. God kept his people safe in Babylon until the promised day of their return. Though many in Israel were destroyed, God preserved those he had taken from Babylon, and one day he would use them to carry out his plan of salvation. We can be sure that God is in control and that God is the king of all other kings. Jesus came to rule over people's hearts by dying for their sins and then being raised to life again. Jesus came to rule over God's kingdom. As ruler of God's kingdom, Jesus is higher and more important than any leader in the past, present, or future. So no matter who is president or prime minister or ruler over a country, Jesus is king. Jesus' kingdom is forever, and Jesus welcomes you with open arms.
It's the song of the redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. Let it rise above the four winds, caught up in the heavenly sound. Praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn.